Tarzan Lives, an exclusive interview with the 8th Duke of Greystoke. Starring me as the editor, Christopher Paul Carey, reading as Philip Jose Farmer, and Chuck Kreegah Loridans as Tarzan Lord Grayson. For a number of years, Mr. Farmer, who recorded the following interview, has been engaged in writing a definitive biography of the man Edgar Rice Burroughs called Tarzan of the Apes. Mr. Farmer's book, Tarzan Alive, is similar in method to Baring Gould's Sherlock Holmes of Baker Street and Parkinson's The Life and Times of Horatio Hornblower, with the very important difference that Mr. Farmer firmly avers that Lord Greystoke, or Tarzan, is really alive. In fact, Mr. Farmer was able to track his subject to Earth in a hotel in Libreville, Gabon, on the coast of West Africa, just above the equator, where he was granted this interview. I met him, Mr. Farmer tells us, in his hotel room, fittingly enough on September 1, Edgar Rice Burroughs' birthday. He is 6'3" and, I suppose, about 240 pounds. I did not have the opportunity to see him in action, of course, but just from the way he moved about the room, I could guess at his immense physical strength. As Burroughs said, he is much more like Apollo than Hercules. His power lies in the quality, not quantity, of his muscles. I don't hesitate to admit that I was off. I was concerned, of course, that after all my research, I still might have been the victim of a hoax. But from the moment I knocked on the door and heard that deep, rich voice say, "Enter," I knew I had the right man. And of course, I was even more convinced when I saw him move, like a leopard, like waterfall. The text of Mr. Farmer's interview follows.
How do you do, Mr. Farmer?
How do you do, Your Grace?
If you don't mind, Mr. Farmer, I should prefer simply to be called John Clayton. I own a good many titles, both real and fictional. But John Clayton, as it were, is my real name, though not my true identity, so to speak, as you apparently know.
Excuse me, sir. Mr. Clayton. Mr. Clayton, you told me over the phone that you would see me for 15 minutes only, so I'd better work fast. I'll start asking you questions right now, if you don't mind.
By all means. You don't have a tape recorder on you, do you? No. Good.
May I ask you, sir, why you were kind enough to grant this interview?
Mr. Farmer, my reasons are my own, but I will say that I appreciate the very great efforts you have gone to researching the details of my life. It is very flattering to me, and I am not entirely immune to that. Besides, you seem to have information about my family that even I myself don't know. Your genealogical researches provoke my own curiosity, which has always been ample. I may ask you a few questions myself.
Of course. First, though, may I ask you how it happens that you seem to speak English as you do, with more or less of an American accent? You speak as though you came from Illinois, which is my own home state. I seem to recall that on the phone you spoke, well, as I imagine Dukes speak, the educated British accent.
I speak more or less as I am spoken to. You will recall that English is not my first spoken language, though it is my first written language. Very unusual business, that. Or even my spoken European language. But the first English-speaking country I visited was the United States, Wisconsin in particular, back in 1909. I was not quite 21 years old at the time, so when English was fairly new to me, I had a rather large dose of America.
Nevertheless, in Britain, I do speak British. I have a gift from mimicry, I suppose you might call it, and I confirm pretty much the dialect of my interlocutors. When I gave my first and only speech in the House of Lords, I did speak as Dukes speak, or at least as Dukes think they speak. You seem nervous, by the way. Would you care for a drink? I believe I will join you in a small scotch.
Thank you. I'm surprised to find you a drinking man. I thought
that I was an abstainer. For many years I was. In my early days among civilized people, I not only saw the results of excess, but I'm afraid committed it myself. For many years I abstained completely. However, I believe the rash impulses of youth are safely behind me now, and I can be abstainous without being teetotal. After all, I am...
You are 82 years old. When this interview is published, you'll be 83. But I suppose as far as physical appearance is concerned, you look about 35. It must be true, then, that the story about the grateful witch doctor who gave you the immortality treatment...
That was in 1912. I was 24 then. So as you see, I have apparently aged about 10 years since. The treatment merely slows down the aging process. Burroughs exaggerated its effects slightly, as he often did. I'll be an old man by the time I'm 150 or so.
I'd like to return to your physical condition. But since you bring up Burroughs, and since Burroughs is the principal source of information about your life and family...
You would like to discuss the accuracy of Burroughs. Go ahead.
Tarzan of the Apes, the first Tarzan book, Burroughs says that in 1888, your mother, then pregnant, accompanied your father on a secret mission to Africa for the British government. They hired a small ship, but the crew mutinied and stranded your parents on the coasts of Africa. They were left on the shores of Portuguese Angola at approximately 10 degrees south latitude, or about 1,500 miles north of Cape Town. But it seems to me that many of the scenes in the book could not have taken place in Angola.
Well, that is correct. Actually, my parents were marooned on the shore of this very country, Gabon, which was then part of French Equatorial Africa. I was born about 190 miles south of here, which is now the Parc National du Petit Congo. Any researcher, I believe, could have deduced that from the facts. There were guerrillas in my natal territory, but they are not guerrillas south of the Congo, and Angola extends far to the south of the Congo. Also, it was a French cruiser that landed near the same spot years later and rescued the party of Professor Porter, including my wife-to-be, Jane, but left behind Lieutenant Darnot, my first civilized friend. Why would a French warship be patrolling the shores of Angola, a Portuguese possession?
Nor are there any lions, zebras, or rhinoceroses in the Gabonese rainforests. What would the lioness who broke Burroughs's... Who broke...
What would... Are you all right, Mr.
I'm a bit nervous, sir.
Sire.
Nor are there any lions and zebras or rhinoceroses in the Gabonese rainforest. What about that lioness whose neck Burroughs said you broke the full Nelson when she was trying to get into your parents' cabin after Jane?
The lioness was actually a leopard. It was about the size of a small lioness. One of the big leopards that the natives call Njugo. I did break his neck. As you know, I had independently invented the full Nelson a few months before when I fought the big Mangani ape that Burroughs calls Turcos.
Well then, how do you explain the discrepancies between Burroughs and the facts?
Mr. Farmer, the relationship between my life and Burroughs' narration of my life is exceedingly complex. I don't choose, for various reasons, to tell you all that I know about Burroughs' methods or my own, but I can tell you a number of his motives, which some of you may have figured out for yourself. First of all, Burroughs was essentially a romancer. He was not obligated to stick to the facts. And even if I had chosen to compel him, litigation would have been involved, and I would have had to appear in court and submit to questioning, which I would rather not have done. I rather appreciate the fears of your own Howard Hughes in this regard. In fact, when Burroughs wrote Tarzan of the Apes, I communicated with him, and I told him he should continue to make the narrative highly romantic, even fantastic. Jane advised that because she said that the people found out I was not a fictional character, I would never again have a moment of privacy. In the second place, Burroughs himself was not always fully informed. He first heard of me in the winter of 1911.
I had then been known to the civilized world for perhaps 2 years, and the records of my existence, including my father's diary, which he kept until his death in Africa, were there in England, within in England. By the way, here are photo stats of the diary. You may examine them, but you may not take them with you. In any case, Burroughs had not been to England, much less to Africa, and had his information by word of mouth at several removes. In many cases, he had to fill in gaps by sheer guesswork, some of which is accurate, some not. For the sake of verisimilitude, Burroughs pretended to be much closer to the sources than was in fact the case. Finally, certain facts are disguised in the books because they are best left disguised. Burroughs gives directions to getting to the lost city of Opar with its spires and domes and vaults of gold and jewels, but these directions will lead the curious nowhere. Not that it matters so much in this case, because I have long since disguised the ruins of Opar completely. You could go there today and never know you were there, but I hope you won't. A few of Burroughs' stories were pure fiction. In Jungle Tales of Tarzan, I am supposed to have shot arrows into the sky in an effort to stop an eclipse of the moon. But the story happens in 1908, and in fact there was no such eclipse visible from my part of Africa that year. Sheer fabrication.
I see from your father's diary that he delivered you himself, though he had nothing but some medical books to go by. You were born a few minutes after midnight of November 22nd, 1888, on the cusp of Sagittarius and Scorpio. Scorpio, the passionate, Sagittarius, the hunter.
I know. I have read much about astrology, though. I believe in it about as much as I believe in the speeches of politicians. Still, Sagittarius, the centaur with the bow, could not have been a better symbol of the half-animal, half-man that I've been. And I am a very good archer indeed. And Scorpios are supposed to be ingenious, creative, true friends, and dangerous enemies, all of which I am. We are also supposed to exude sexual power.
Attempting to seduce you. You are certainly not the inarticulate ape man of the movies. What you say about being a good archer, however, reminds me of some critics who maintain that you could not have accomplished this. They refer to Marshall McLuhan's thesis that only literate peoples can produce excellent marksmen.
I've read The Mechanical Bride and Understanding Media. McLuhan forgets the medieval English bowman, who was certainly illiterate, but undoubtedly a great marksman. And the critics forget that I taught myself to read and write English. I was not illiterate, though I couldn't speak the language.
What do you think of the Tarzan movies?
I saw the first one in 1920, the one with Elmo Lincoln. I came very near to leaping up onto the stage and tearing the picture apart. That fake jungle, those doped-up, scraggly circus cats. Lincoln was built more like a gorilla than me, and he wore a headband, which I would never have done. All that swinging on the vine, his movie invention as well as his cheetah, the chimpanzee. Nowhere, even in Burroughs, will you find me swinging on vines. Though it is true that lie did greatly exaggerate my tree traveling abilities. I'm too heavy to go skipping through the arboreal avenues like a monkey. And the chimpanzees would never trust me because they identified me with the great apes and brought me up. They used to eat chimps when they could catch them. But later on, I began to find the Tarzan movies more amusing than disgusting. Jane helped me learn to tolerate them.
Arthur Kessler wrote an article claiming you couldn't have escaped being mentally retarded. He said there have been a few authentic cases of children raised by baboons or wolves and then found by humans. These were unable to master any language. Apparently, if the child doesn't experience language before a certain age, it is forever incapable of learning speech.
Kessler must not have bothered to read the Tarzan books. Otherwise, he would have learned that the apes did have a language. He should have deduced, as many have, that the great apes, or Mangani, were really near humans, hominids, in fact. Remember what I said about the sketchy information upon which Burroughs' early books were based? He supplied missing data with imagination or even misinformation. He made up names. He put animals in the Japanese jungles that did not belong there. He described the Mangani as great apes. My father thought they were apes and so called them in his diary, but my father was not a zoologist or a paleontologist. The Mangani were a very rare, nearly extinct, even 80 years ago, genus of hominids, halfway between ape and man. They might have been a great giant variety of Australopithecus robustus. The fossil remains of this hominid may have been found by Leakey in East Africa, you know. The Mangani, and I use Burroughs' word for them, since their own term is impronounceable, jawbreakers, had crested skulls and massive jaws. They had long arms and often used their knuckles to assist them in walking. But they had man-like hips and leg bones. They could walk upright when they chose. Burroughs later had better information about his great apes. However, for the sake of consistency, he described them in the later novels as he had done earlier on. He slipped in the sixth book, Jungle Tales of Tarzan, when he said that they walked upright and were man-like. I can speak Mangani fluently, of course, but I can't pronounce it quite perfectly. The Mangani oral structure is different from man's, and many of their speech sounds have no exact equivalent in human speech. So though I can speak English with any of several accents, I always speak Mangani with human accent.
Did the big Mangani, Turkaz, really abduct Jane and try to rape her? And you killed him with your father's hunting knife?
Yes. And there you see, by the way, another reason why the Mangani should not be classified as apes. They are capable of raping a human being, whereas a gorilla is not. I once read in the memoirs of Trader Horn about a white trader who put a male gorilla in a cage with a native girl. The gorilla did nothing but sulk in one corner while the poor girl wept in the other. Horn said he shot the white man when he found out about it. In any case, the gorillas have 48 chromosomes, humans only 46. So a gorilla-human hybrid is not possible, but Burroughs knew of instances of offspring born to a human and a Mangani.
Albert Schweitzer maintained that Trader Horn, aside from some trifling discrepancies, was generally accurate. Did you know that Schweitzer built his house on the site of Horn's trading post?
Yes, at Analengo, a little distance from Lambrin and Magawa River. I know it well. There's a Catholic mission there, founded in 1886. That's where Lieutenant Darno and I came out of the jungle on our trek to civilization.
Would you care to comment on how you taught yourself to read and write English? As far as I know, this is a unique intellectual feat, especially since you had never heard a word of it spoken.
I was about 10 years old when I discovered how to unlock the door to my parents' cabin. And there I found, as you have read in Burroughs, a number of books, all of them perfectly meaningless to me, of course, but one of them was a big illustrated children's alphabet book with pictures of bowmen and the like, you know, and legends like A is for Archer and who shoots the bow, that sort of thing. Finally, it dawned on me that the writing had something to do with the picture. And I spent, I don't know how long, puzzling it out. When I was 17, I could read a child's primer. I call the letters little bugs, or the Mandani equivalent thereof. And I knew how they worked. One detail you may find rather amusing is this. I had to invent, and did invent, my own manner of pronouncing the English words, which had nothing to do, of course, with real English, but was governed by the usages of Mandani grammar. Mandani has two genders, indicated by the prefixes bu for the masculine and mu for the feminine. Now, I suppose that the capital letters were masculine since they were bigger and the rest feminine. And as children will do when they know the alphabet but don't yet know how to read, I pronounce each letter separately using arbitrary symbols taken from Mangani. I pronounce the G as la and the O as tu and D as mo. Now take the English word for God. Adding the prefixes, I pronounced it Bulamamamuno, The equivalent in English would be he, ji, she, o, she, di. Now that's very cumbersome, of course, but it worked. I could read my father's books and know what I was reading. I had no idea how to write my Mangani name, but I had seen a picture of a little white boy, which in Anglo-Mangani, I suppose you might call it, is Bumo Dumo Tamuro, or he, she, be she, o, she, why. That's what I called myself.
Burroughs says that when you discovered intruders who had messed up the cabin, you printed a threatening note to them. You signed it with your Mangani name. How could you do that if you didn't know how to write it in English?
I didn't. I printed a translation of my Mangani name, White Skin, which Burroughs wrote Tarzan. When Burroughs wrote Tarzan in the 80s, he had no record of the exact text of the note. He made up a text, and he did not care to take time out from the action to explain that I couldn't use my Mangani name. Remember, he was first and foremost a storyteller.
Your reading must have given you some strange ideas about the outside world. You had no proper references to give you a full comprehension of the books.
My ideas were no stranger than the reality. My initial encounter with human beings were extremely unpleasant. The first human being I ever saw had just murdered my foster mother. To him, she was an ape, but to me, she was the most beautiful and loving and lovable person in the world. The first time I saw a white man, one was murdering another. I am fortunate that that didn't make me shun mankind forever. Otherwise, I'd never have known human love.
When you matured and discovered that you were not an ape, but a man, didn't you think of turning to the native tribes for companionship?
No. I hated them all for a long time because I blamed them for my foster mother's death. Also, they were cannibals. Anybody not of their tribe was meat to them. And they had had unfortunate experiences with white men. In addition to that, the women coated their bodies and hair with rancid palm nut oil. I have an unusually keen sense of smell, and consequently they repelled me. Still, if Jane had not come along.
Burroughs portrays you as free of racial prejudice.
Like Mark Twain, I have only one prejudice. That is against the human race.
Let me not pursue that further. Many readers have found your behavior with Jane when you were alone in the jungle incredibly chivalrous. Burroughs attributes this to heredity, but no one today would accept this explanation.
Remember, I read all the novels, Victorian novels, mind you, in my father's library, and I read Mallory's book about King Arthur and the knights and the fair ladies. I believed in chivalry, and quite literally, and I was in love with Jane. I did not want to offend her. Besides, the Mangani have a code of ethics, you know. They are not apes. They do not copulate in public. They demand, though they cannot always get, marital fidelity. They punish rape with death if the injured party wishes it. Consider all the factors and you'll find my behavior credible enough.
You became chief of the black tribe, which Burroughs called the Waziri. Are you aware that Robert Louis Taylor, in his biography of W.C. Fields, says that Fields once went with Tex Rickard on a world tour, and that Fields entertained a tribe of naked Waziri? That would have been in 1906 or 1907, several years before you encountered the Waziri. Did your Waziri ever say anything about Fields?
I have no comment on that, I'm afraid.
How much of Burroughs's Tarzan and the Lion Man is true? It seems to me that Burroughs wrote it mainly to satirize Hollywood.
Yes, nearly everything in that book is fiction. But I did visit Hollywood once, though I told no one except Burroughs who I was, of course.
Did you actually try out for the role of Tarzan in a movie? And were you rejected because the producer said you weren't the type?
No, I wouldn't be surprised, though, if such a thing were to happen. In any case, I went there too late to try out for the Wise Ruler Tarzan the Ape Man, and too early for the Buster Crab movie, Tarzan the Fearless. I did meet Burroughs secretly, of course. I liked him very much. He was gentle and broad-minded, and he didn't take himself or his works too seriously. He saw many things wrong in civilization, many sickening things, and he satirized them in his books. You know, but his mockery was Voltaire's, not Swift's. He was never sour or snarly. Since we are now discussing authors, let me indulge my curiosity a moment. I gather that you have been led to me by a fairly elaborate trail. Would you mind explaining to me how you first caught my scent, as it were?
Well, I had long suspected that Burroughs, Arthur Conan Doyle, and George Bernard Shaw had all written stories about your family. Each, however, used more or less sophisticated systems of code names for your various relatives. If these codes could be cracked and used as guides to the right places, Burke's Peerage, for instance, they would lead me right to you. And as you see, they have. The reasoning I have employed is long and complex, and I hope you will be willing to delay a full understanding until I can send you a copy of my book, since our time today is short. Suffice it to say that I have shown you are closely related to the men who were the living prototypes of Doc Savage, Nero Wolfe, Bulldog Drummond, Sherlock Holmes, Lord Peter Wimsey, Leopold Bloom, and Richard Wentworth, also known as G8, the Spider, and the Shadow, and a number of other notable characters in 19th and 20th century fiction.
Indeed.
I have also found the explanation for the remarkable, almost superhuman powers exhibited by yourself and many members of your family. As you know, a monument marks the spot today where a meteorite hit Old Newton, Yorkshire in 1795. It just so happened that three coaches were passing by when the meteorite struck, and in them were the third Duke of Greystoke and his wife, the rich gentleman Fitzwilliam Darcy of Pemberley House, and his wife Elizabeth Bennet, the heroine of Pride and Prejudice, Sherlock Holmes's great-grandparents, and a number of others. All the ladies were pregnant. Everybody was exposed to the radiation of the meteorite. Ionization accompanies the fall of these, you know. And the radiation must have caused favorable mutations in the party. Otherwise, how do you explain the nova of genetic splendor in the descendants of these people, including yourself?
I will not say that I am entirely convinced. Nevertheless, yours is a very probable theory. My own skeletal bones are half again as thick as normal, which might well indicate that I'm a mutant. Moreover, even before I received the immortality treatment from the witch doctor, I was developing oddly. Though I had no one of my own race to compare myself with at 18 years of age, and grew 3 more inches in the next 2 years, I did not have to shave until I was 20. I have never been ill or had a toothache, so your mutation theory seems likely enough. And now, I'm afraid our interview is over. May I have the photo stacks back, please?
What? My time's up.
I don't need a watch to know how many minutes have passed. Goodbye. I won't be seeing you again. May I ask you to remain in this room a few minutes and allow me to leave first? I have already checked out and will soon be gone.
May I ask where you're going?
To arrange a seemingly fatal accident. Too many people have been wondering why I look so young. One reason I gave you this interview is that I'm disappearing. Your book won't help anyone find me, but I hold you to your promise not to reveal my identity for 10 years. I'll be living incognito with Jane in various countries and various names. Occasionally I'll return to the jungle. There are still vast tracts in the rainforest of Gabon and the Aturi where the only men are a few pygmies. The rainforest may disappear someday, but I think that worldwide pollution is going to result in a collapse of civilization and a drastic reduction of the population. Perhaps the forest will be spared after all, and many of the species now threatened with extinction will come back. In any case, I intend to survive. If I don't, well, death gets us all sooner or later. And I won't be able to worry about it being sooner if I'm dead. As I told you, I'll be old enough when I'm 150. Send your books to my bankers in Europe.
Then Mr. Farmer tells us he left the room. the exclusive interview with Lord Greystoke, we'd be happy to field those.
Do you know if Jane was also then given the treatment by a witch doctor?
We believe so. No, not by that witch doctor. Some little something called a kuvuru pill. See Tarzan's Quest.
So, in the Tarzan books, by Burroughs, Tarzan actually got two immortality treatments. And the witch doctor treatment was administered in 1912, but Burroughs actually wrote about it in one of the later books. And there was another book called Tarzan's Quest, where Jane and a few others got the Kuvuru pills. They may not work exactly the same. You know, they may function a little bit differently, but Jane had some kind of elixir.
And Nikima did too.
Yes.
And as I recall, when I got the first treatment from the witch doctor, he said, ooh, ee, ooh, ah, ah, king, tang, wah, wah, dee, bitch.
Over and over for a month.
Question for Lord Greystoke.
Kahuda!
Never talk about my mother that way. I will slit your throat.
Kahuda.
How many children do you have?
I've been alive for a long time. Known to the world, I have an adopted son. His name is John Drummond, but he became John Clayton, and he became known by the name Korak. I have a daughter named Charlotte, and I have another daughter named Penelope, and I have another son named John. John's a very popular name. There was one night, I'm a little hazy about, after leaving Opar with Law. I'm a little hazy about that, so perhaps their modesty prevents me from saying anything else.
Mike.
Is there any chance you guys are going to go do this at the dump dump?
I'm not going to make it.
You, in the back.
Mr. Farmer, a question. I've read recently you have also produced a log purportedly by none other than Phileas Fogg. Did your researches into Tarzan lead you to this, or is this an independent investigation?
Careful what you say, Mr. Farmer.
Well, my source, let's see. What's his name? My source met in an unfortunate accident, but yes, there were connections.
Any more questions?
One last one, sir. Why were you so cruel to this devoted man who gave you your drinks?
He reminds me of a pygmy that vexed me greatly in my youth.
I see. Thank you.
How many times have you all done this job? This so far.
This would be the first.
All right. Thanks.